Welcome to Gospel Truth with Andrew Wommack, a teaching ministry that focuses on God's unconditional love and grace. And now, Andrew talks with Travis Adams about his encounter with grace.
Well, welcome to another very special edition of the Gospel Truth. And I tell you, I am so blessed that we now have this Grace Encounters, where we are giving the stories of some people that have encountered the Lord in a miraculous way. Of course, every one of us, it's miraculous what God has done. Even though I hadn't been through most of the stuff that other people have, I am so thankful for the grace of God. But every once in a while, you find these people that it's amazing that they're still alive today. And today we have with us Travis Adams. And so we're so glad to have you, Travis.
Thanks, Andrew.
And I tell you, he has a miraculous testimony. We're going to be talking to him personally, but first of all, I want you to watch this little short clip that we have. My media department put together a story about him, and I think you'll really be blessed. And then we'll come back and get it straight from the man himself. So watch this.
Travis Adams was born again in a drug rehab, but because he didn't have an understanding of grace, he lived his life afraid that God was mad at him. As a result, he found himself repeatedly going back through the same cycle of sin. That is, until he came across the free teachings of Andrew Wommack. This is the Grace Encounter of Travis Adams.
I started off with good intentions until I moved into a house with a girl, one of my friends, mutual friends, and we were living together growing marijuana. And laying on my bed, I just got frustrated and said, God, why can't I go to sleep? And the Lord spoke to me and said, Travis, you know what to do. And I said, God, I can't do that though. I got a harvest of marijuana coming up in a couple of weeks, you know, and I was looking forward to harvesting this marijuana and making a lot of money and things like that. But then the Lord spoke back to me. I mean, this was on the inside of me, so strong and clear. He said, son, you need to do this right now. And I just got up right off the floor and went and grabbed a few clothes and jumped in my car and moved out of that house the same day. Left everything I owned there except for a few clothes and moved back into the apartment with my mom. I woke up in my mom's apartment and I was just hungry to hear the word. So I was flipping through the channels and I came across Andrew Wommack, and he was just sitting at his table and speaking. And I just recognized this is a preacher. And so I just stopped and I started listening to him.
The truth is, God's kind. You know what? God is a good God. God's long-suffering with you. God's not ticked off at you. God's not angry. He's not even mad. You know what? God's in a good mood. God likes you.
And he just started saying things like God is a good God. And he's not mad at you. He's not going to kill you. And when he said that, the Holy Spirit just bore witness in me so strong. And I knew that God was speaking to me through Andrew. And I literally fell off my couch onto my knees. And while he was saying these things, and just wept. And I felt the love of God. And I was instantly set free.
Harris Bible College invites you to expand your vision.
He finished his message and Andrew started talking about his Bible college. I heard the voice of the Holy Spirit speak to me so clear, and he said, I'm going to take you to that Bible college one day. You're going to go there. I immediately took down the number on the TV, called the ministry, you know, got free tapes because I didn't have any money to give the ministry, so they sent me three free tapes. I remember looking through the list of all these different teachings, and I was just praying and asking God. I was like, God, what else do I need to get from this ministry? And when my eyes came on spirit, soul, and body, they literally just became alive and jumped off the page. And that came to me. And man, when I heard that, it kept me from going back into, you know, God being mad at me, or no, he's not mad at me, or whatever, because it just told me who I was in Christ. So after I got Andrew's teaching in the mail, I just started devouring everything he had. I just kept ordering everything he had.
As Travis continued to renew his mind in the Word, he learned how to be more sensitive to the voice of the Holy Spirit, which became apparent when he began to hear a specific scripture repeatedly in his mind.
And I didn't even know what it was, but it was, "You shall not die, but live and declare the glory of God." And I finally went to my Bible study leader, Steve, and I said, "Hey, Steve, God has been telling me all year long that I'm not going to die, but live and declare the glory of God. I don't know what that means, but that just keeps happening." And he's, you know, said, "Well, try to find out, pray about it, ask the Lord what he's trying to tell you."
A week later, Travis decided he would visit an old friend from his past, hoping to share his newfound faith.
But on my way over to his house, I knew God was speaking to me and telling me not to go over there. I just knew it. I had a check in my spirit. Something was not right. And I honestly, unfortunately, kind of reasoned in my head and thought, "Well, God thinks that I'm going to get back into my old drugs and thinking I'm not going to do that."
Later that night, Travis became the target for a homicide, an attack from the same old friend that the Holy Spirit was warning him from visiting.
He came over to my house and knocked me over the head with a crowbar, knocked me out, and then dragged my body back over into this field and laid me down in the grass, and he continued to beat my head over my head with a crowbar and left me in this field to die. Next thing I know, I'm waking up in a hospital 3 days later. And that man that I had told the week before that something's going to happen to me, but I'm going to live through it, he was there with the doctors. And he looked down at me, this man did, and he said, "Travis," he said, "do you remember what the Lord told you?" And he said that I looked up at him with one eye open, and I had all these wires and hoses coming out of me. And I just, with all of my strength I mustered, I just said, "I shall not die, but live and declare the glory of God." And then he looked over at all the doctors and he said, "That man's going to be all right."
12 days later, Travis walked out of the hospital completely healed, and his attacker was arrested and sentenced to 12 years in prison. Through his local church, God began confirming it was time for him to go to Karis Bible College. Travis packed up his car and moved to Colorado to begin classes in August 2008.
Being at Karis was amazing, just the things that God taught me. He really taught me how to live by faith, because I didn't have the money to pay for school, and next thing I know, somebody's paying for my tuition and I don't even know who it is. I went through school and maybe out of my own pocket only paid like $200 or $300 out of it. God brought in all the rest of the money.
Travis began working in Andrew's phone center as a prayer minister. He also started working in the warehouse of Messenger International, where he continues to work today, packaging and shipping out materials by John and Lisa Bevere to be sent out all over the world.
But John and Andrew were my spiritual fathers. To be able to work for both of them and be under both of them is an honor. The message of grace is something that has radically transformed my life. It wasn't until I got that message that I was truly set free. You know, if it weren't for partners, if it weren't for people that were sending Andrew, enabling him to get this message out, my life would, I never would have heard of Andrew. I may not even be alive right now.
As partners with Andrew Wommack Ministries, you are helping transform the lives of people like Travis through the free teachings of God's love and grace.
But I wouldn't be where I am today if it were not for the teachings of Andrew. I can't emphasize enough how powerful they are and what they've done for me. I will spend the rest of my life teaching and preaching what he's preached to me.
Man, isn't that awesome? Praise God for Jesus.
Amen.
Man, the way that he reaches out to us. So we have Travis Adams right here in our studio. And Travis, such an honor to have you. And I remember when you came to school, man. I didn't know all of this story, but it is tremendous what God has done in your life.
It's amazing. And I'm honored to be here. Thanks for having me.
Well, you got to telling me that I think it was 10 years old that you started smoking dope.
Yeah, my older brother and his best friend took me down into our hay barn behind my house into a camper and introduced me to marijuana and had me smoke my first joint with them when I was 10 or 11. I think it might have been 10.
And so after that time, I guess you just continued.
Yeah, when that happened, I enjoyed it so much. I basically made a statement that this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. I'm going to smoke dope and I'm going to.
That's quite an ambition.
Yeah, that's what I did.
You had high standards, didn't you?
I remember saying that this is all I need. I'm never going to do anything else. I'm just going to smoke marijuana. And before long, I found myself shooting needles in my arm and do another any kind of drug I could get
so
my hand
happened?
On.
The marijuana didn't suffice?
Yeah, it just led to another thing, you know.
After a while, you get to where you have to have a bigger
yeah,
high or something.
That was exactly what happened. And I grew up with my vision as a teenager was that I was going to be a pothead and a drug dealer for the rest of my life till the day that I died. And I expected that to be in my mid 20s or 30s, depending, you know, how I was going, the route
and
that
you
I
were
was
excited
going.
About that?
That's what I wanted to do. That's how much I enjoyed it. That's how much I enjoyed the drugs. And
how did this affect your parents?
My mom and dad got divorced around the time that I started doing this, 10 or 11. And my mom moved out. My dad flew for American Airlines, and he was gone a lot of times. So we had a babysitter in the house. But so they were already apart, and it took a toll on our whole family. And before this, I was into sports and doing things with my dad and things like that. And then all of that just kind of went out the window. I became rebellious and just in all kinds of criminal activity, breaking into people's places and stealing their stuff to buy more drugs. So
you said in this video that you were saved in a drug rehab deal. That was Teen Challenge?
Yes. The first time that I encountered the Lord was in Teen Challenge. I was court ordered to go there for a burglary charge, and I had to go for a year. And I went to Teen Challenge, and I got there. I wasn't planning on changing. I was planning on doing my time and getting out and going right back into it, but God had other plans. And I encountered him in a very powerful way in a chapel service in Teen Challenge.
But you didn't have the word to establish in the grace of God. You know, this is a great testimony, Travis, that getting born again is absolutely essential, and it makes you go to heaven, and that's wonderful. But man, you need to understand the word of God to be able to live in this life.
Yes, sir. I didn't understand the grace of God and the love of God, and I didn't understand the gospel. And so what happened when I got out of Teen Challenge, I got back around my old friends. I didn't have a place to stay. My dad wouldn't let me come home. And so I ended up staying with old friends just to find a place to lay my head down at night. And, you know, the scripture says, don't be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits.
Absolutely.
And I tried to, you know, stay straight for so long, but eventually I started smoking dope again. And because I didn't understand the grace of God and the message of the gospel, when that happened, I felt like God was done with me. He didn't want anything else to do with me. You know, I had my chance. He saved me, but then I blew it, and now I'm gone again.
And you probably were worse than before because this time you'd already tried Jesus and thought that, well, you couldn't do that, and so there was no other option.
I went back into the drugs three times harder than I was before.
And, as a believer.
As a believer.
You know, a lot of people don't understand this. They think that if you have Jesus in your life, everything just automatically works out. But it's the truth that sets you free. And if you don't know the truth, you aren't free.
Yes, sir. Yep. And that's exactly what happened. I didn't know the truth. And I knew God was real. I always believed God was real ever since I was a kid. But I just, like I said, didn't know the truth. And I didn't know how good He was. I didn't know the grace and the mercy and the sacrifice that Jesus made.
And so in this video, it showed you growing marijuana with that girl. That was after you got out of the drug rehab, after you were born again.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I ended up moving from Georgia, where I was grew up, to Kansas to live with my mom. And I tried to move to Kansas and start afresh.
Trying
and
to get
away from all of it, get away from my old friends. And I ended up getting back into it up there again. And once again, just thought, well, God's through with me. You know, He doesn't want anything to do with me. I might as well just go all out until I die. And that's the way I was heading. And I was living in a house with that girl and growing the marijuana. And the Lord started dealing with me. I just knew the Spirit of God was drawing me back to Himself, and I knew it. And long story short, I just hit my knees in the middle of this house, and I just cried out to God. I was saying, God, please come back into my life. Please forgive me. And And I just felt this weight pressing down on me, and there's nothing, it wouldn't lift. But I kept hearing the name Jesus just flooding through my mind, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I just knew that God was telling me to call on His name, the name of Jesus. And so I cried out to Jesus and just started, Jesus, come back into my life and forgive me. And that weight just, I haven't found words yet to describe how it felt, but that weight just evaporated off of me. And I felt Jesus come into me fill me. And I was instantly set free. Never had another desire for drugs. Got up and ran out of that house and moved out the same day. Never had any other desires for drugs or anything. And that's when I started
seeking. So did you explain anything to this girl?
I told her before I did that, I told her that I was thinking about giving my life back to the Lord. And she said, well, if you do, you know, just, you know, give me some time to find another renter for the house. And I said, well, I'm going to do it. And so I did. And that's what happened. And then I moved out of that house and back into an apartment with my mom. And it wasn't long after that I started experiencing so much demonic warfare, just having these thoughts go through my mind. Are you really going to give up all those drugs? Are you really going to give up the money and all of those things? And just so much was going on, a lot of spiritual warfare.
So even though you made this profound commitment to the Lord, the devil did not just run and hide. He didn't want to let you go.
Full force, he came to try to get me to go back on that and get back into it. And that's when, well, I think first what happened was I went to a Bible study and I got filled with the Holy Spirit. It's another very long story, powerful story, but I got filled with the Holy Spirit. And I felt wind blowing on the inside of me, just like on the day of the book of Acts. And I felt this wind blowing inside of me and cleaning up all this stuff that was in me. And I got filled with the Spirit. And it was not long after that that I was searching the TV, and I came across your program on the TV. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
And so another point that was in that video was that the devil took your good intentions about wanting to witness to a guy.
Yeah.
But God was telling you not to go there, and you leaned under your own understanding, and it nearly got you killed.
Yeah, that happened. Well, at the beginning of 2004, the Spirit of God started speaking to me. I didn't even know it was a scripture, but it just kept coming up out of me. I shall not die, but live and declare the glory of God. And I would be walking here and there. I totaled my car the day after I gave my life to the Lord, and it was a miracle that I survived that. And
you're a walking miracle.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
And so the Spirit of God kept speaking that scripture to me. And like I said, I think I heard it on somebody's worship CD or something, but I didn't know it was a scripture. It just stuck out to me when this person said it. And it just kept coming up. The Holy Spirit kept bringing that up. I will not die, but live and declare the glory of God. And that was the beginning of 2004. And it was about, I think, May 1st, 2004, that my best friend came over to my apartment and got me outside. And when I wasn't looking, he hit me over the head with a crowbar in the back of the head. And
that was your best friend?
Yeah.
I'd hate to see what your worst friend was like.
He was a friend of mine that we were doing the drugs together and all of that. And so it's a long story, but he hit me over the head with a crowbar and knocked me out. And then he dragged me over into a field next to my apartment complex, and he continued to beat me over the head with a crowbar multiple times.
Crowbar will kill you.
Yeah, he split my skull open on this side. And on the back, I had multiple skull fractures and other things. So it's a powerful testimony how the Lord brought me out of that.
But God had prepared you by giving you that scripture.
He did. And I kept speaking that word out, and I believe that saved my life. Amen. Just by speaking that word, that I would not die but live and declare the glory of God.
You know, this is the faithfulness of God, Travis, that here you were. You'd made so many mistakes, and yet God was preparing you and speaking to you, and He knew that you were going to disobey Him when you heard the Spirit say, don't go over there.
Yeah.
And yet He still prepared you, still loved you.
I didn't share that, but I was on my way over to this guy's house, and I knew God was telling me not to go. I just knew it down inside. I knew I didn't have peace about it. My spirit was in a knot. And I reasoned that, you know, that the Lord thought that I was going to get in trouble again, but I wanted to witness to Him. I wanted to tell Him about Jesus. And
Good intentions,
but yeah.
And I tell you what, you just got to obey God.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's awesome.
It was powerful.
So you got out of the hospital. Did you have any permanent or lasting effects?
No, I got out of the hospital. I walked out 12 days later I had brain damage and I had hearing loss in my right ear while I was in the hospital. I was in a wheelchair. I couldn't walk. And but I walked out, and the only thing that I had for about 3 months afterwards was I had a constant ringing in my ear. And no, it was a dizziness. I was dizzy. I would look up and I would start getting dizzy really bad. But I had heard Charles Capps speaking about faith and confession. Mm-hmm. I found a book of his on my living room floor and I was reading it and found out the power of that. And I just was speaking over my body that I'm healed. And about 3 months later, I just noticed one day, it just kind of just dawned on me one day that I was no longer dizzy.
Amen.
And I haven't had any other issues. So.
And so you came to CBC in 2008.
Yes, sir.
So how did that affect you?
Well, actually, I came in 2006. I came in 2006, graduated in 2008. Oh, okay. And CBC was amazing. It changed my life. You know, it's one thing. I started listening to your teachings because I saw you speak on the love of God on December 23rd, 2003, and that just instantly set me free because I was having these thoughts go through my mind that God was, you know, he was still mad at me or whatever. But when I saw you speaking about the love of God, that just, the Lord bore witness so strongly. And like I just fell on my face and just started weeping in the presence of God because I was set free. And I started getting all of your materials, all your CDs and resources for free, and was listening to you. But coming to CBC, it was like all of that amplified. I mean, because the atmosphere at the school and the people around me and instructors.
It's not just me. The yeah. other instructors are yeah. powerful. Plus, you got a job with John Bevere and
I
got
did.
To know him, and he spoke into your life.
Yes, sir.
It was a turning point for
yes,
you.
Yes, sir. I found one of his books in Teen Challenge on a bookshelf, and that planted a seed in me. And later down the road, the Lord brought me to his ministry. Actually, I came out here to go to Bible college. You know, around the same time, the Lord opened up a door for me to work for John and was able to, and I still work for John now and travel with him and do things. So.
That's awesome. And yeah. you worked here for a while.
I worked for you.
In our production?
It was actually in the phone center.
Oh, phone center?
Yeah. I worked as a prayer minister for a couple of years and awesome testimonies of that.
So we're running short of time. I hate to say it, but real quickly, what would you say to a person that just feels like God had given up on them like you felt about you?
Well,
how would you say?
I would just say that the Lord's arm is not too short that it cannot reach, and his ear is not too heavy that it cannot hear, and there's hope. There's a lot of people in my generation that I talk to that are hopeless. And they don't know God. They, like me, they don't know how good God is. And I would just say that nobody's too far gone.
Amen.
Nobody's too far gone that God can't reach them and get a hold of them. And he's chasing after them even now, you know, and they just need to surrender,
Amen.
You know, bow the knee.
So I agree. And I hope and believe that as you watch this program that you're going to be encouraged by Travis Adams' testimony that, praise God, God wouldn't leave him alone even though he decided to go away a couple of times, but God pursued him. God's pursuing you. So yeah. I want to encourage you to listen. Get his testimony that you saw today on this DVD, and there's also four other testimonies here about how God's grace reached people. It'll be a blessing to you. So listen to our announcer, and please call or write today.
We hope you've been encouraged by the testimony you saw in today's program. If you'd like to watch this story again or share it with someone else, you can get it on the Grace Encounters DVD, which includes four additional stories of people who encountered grace in such a way that their lives were changed forever. This inspirational DVD is available for a gift of any amount when you contact us. It's the faithful support of our grace partners that makes it possible for Andrew to proclaim the life-changing gospel around the world. If you'd like to help Andrew take the good news of the gospel to the ends of the earth, consider becoming a grace partner today by going to awmi.net. Your support will help change countless lives forever. If you'd like to learn more about the blessing associated with partnership, make sure to order Andrew's complete series titled The Power of Partnership. You can get it in either a CD or DVD album for a gift of any amount when you contact us. You can become a Grace Partner or order resources through our website at awmi.net. While there, you can discover more product details and download many free resources. Or call our helpline Monday through Friday from 4:30 a.m. to 9:30 p.m. Mountain Time. Our helpline number is 719-635-1111. To write us, use the address on your screen. We appreciate your generosity and hope to hear from you today.
Hi, I'm Coach Tony Dungy. To all the men out there, I'm inviting you to join Andrew Wommack, James Brown, and me at the Men's Advance in Woodland Park, Colorado, March 8, 9, and 10.
Hello, this is Andrew Wommack, and I'd just like to encourage you to pray about giving and helping us to complete the construction up in Woodland Park at the sanctuary. You know, between now and the end of the year, all of your gifts that you give will go on the 2017 tax year. And I'd just like to encourage you to participate and give and become a part of this. Your year-end giving could make a huge difference in what we're doing. We are about $9 million away from having our auditorium completely finished, but we just need your help. So pray about it. I encourage you to join us, and you will be blessed by the Lord 100-fold in this life.
The construction at Charis Bible College is all about transforming lives, developing leaders, and changing the world. You can give a tax-deductible year-end gift by going to awmi.net or calling 719-635-1111. Thank you for caring about the message of God's unconditional love and grace.
In every society, there are seven areas of influence, or mountains, in which Christians are called to lead. And God is summoning His children to disciple nations and shift the spiritual atmosphere by taking our mountains. Charis Third Year will equip you to influence and lead in business, creative arts, media, ministry, missions, practical government, worship, and in leadership.
And it's really about impacting the kingdom God's way.
If you really want the opportunity to grow in the gift that you know God's placed in you, this is an excellent way to do it.
Which mountain will you take for the kingdom?
I'd like to encourage you to pray about whether or not God wants you to participate in our Charis Bible College. You know, Bible college is powerful. We are seeing people's lives change, and I know that some of you are thinking, well, I can't come to Colorado. Well, we have extension schools literally scattered all over the world. And somebody says, but there isn't one in my area. Well, we've got an online course where you actually become a part of a class. You can work at your own pace, but you do have to complete the materials in a certain given time. We've got a lot of ways for you to take advantage of it. So please pray about it and then join us at Charis Bible College. I want to let you know that we are doing what we call a live Bible study every Tuesday night at 6 o'clock Mountain Standard Time. We are broadcasting from our facilities here in Woodland Park, and we are just sharing the word, and it's actually live. You can text in your questions. You can call and ask for prayer, but we will answer as many of your questions as we can, about 25, 30 minutes worth of teaching and maybe 25 minutes worth of answering questions. It's just a great interactive thing every Tuesday night, 6 o'clock p.m. Mountain Standard Time.